Hello everyone, we are at IIT Roorkee today and we'll be here for today and tomorrow. We'll be interacting with professors, students, and most importantly, we'll know what IIT Roorkee is doing in the recent research scene in India, what are the highlights of their research, and besides, we'll just check around the campus, we'll sit with the students, and we'll also get to know some of the unique places in IIT Roorkee, such as we are at the HB Medlicott Museum of Geology, which was the dream of Professor D.C. Srivastava, and he was the former head of earth science in IIT Roorkee. And so we are going to meet the professor today, and we'll check out this amazing museum. It's a dream for earth science students. They have an amazing collection of rocks from all across the world, and not just rocks, they also have elephant bones which are 2 to 5 million years old. So let's check out the museum. Hello, sir.
Hello.
Nice to meet you. This is an amazing place you
Same
have got
here. Thank you very much.
So, tell us, why is it named HB Medlicott?
Well, we named this museum HB Medlicott Museum of Geology because Professor HB Medlicott was the first professor of geology in the country, first full professor of geology in the country. And he was here. He was professor at Thompson College of Engineering. He joined Thompson College of Engineering on 15th of August 1854.
Okay.
Actually, to tell you a little bit history about geology in India, it was around 1850 that the modern geology education started in India. And 1850 was the year when Geological Survey of India was established in Calcutta. Thomas Oldham was the first superintendent of Geological Survey of India.
So this is Thomas Oldham. That is H.B.
Medlicott.
Okay.
So soon after, on 15th August 1854, H.B. Medlicott joined as first professor of geology in Thompson College of Engineering. So we dedicated this museum to Professor H.B. Medlicott.
So how long did it take for you to create this museum or get everything in order, plan everything out, collect the specimens?
Well, it is not yet complete. Right, museums can always be improved. There is always a scope for improvement of the museum. We are striving hard to make it better and better. But to get it in this shape, it took me 3 years, 2015 to 2018. If you ask me, hey Deepak, what did you do between 2015 to 18? I would just say I built the museum.
And so tell us more about what is unique about this museum. Why did you create this museum? What is the purpose for students?
Right. Well, the main objective of this museum is to attract good young minds, young generation of India, to earth sciences, to geology, and pursue them to take geology as a career. We need bright scientists, bright geophysicists, bright geologists who would study geology in our country. We get very good students who are 17, 18 years old, and when they visit a museum which is good, they are attracted towards the subject. If the museum is bad, he said, this is not what I am going to do. So the museum has to be good.
So we are seeing so many amazing samples over here.
Right.
And I can see at the gate there is an amazing amethyst sample. It's
right.
Just mind-blowing the way it looks. So can we go there? Let's tell us a little
right.
more about that sample.
Right.
Just look at that.
This is a sample of amethyst which has been imported from Brazil. Amethyst is basically a semi-precious stone now. Greeks used to believe that if they drank in a glass which is made up of amethyst, the drunkenness will not be there.
Wow.
Or the effect of the drunkenness will be less. This crystal is actually a geode. It's a big cavity. It's a very large cavity in the rock, in the mountain. And this whole cavity has been cut in two halves. One half is here, one half is in Brazil, and this has been polished and kept over here.
So it's like an enclosed pod.
Yeah, it's like a very big capsule.
Okay.
It's like a very, very large size capsule.
Okay.
In which these crystals have grown, and these crystals are very large and attractive because they crystallize very slowly, and there were a lot of gases in the fluid from which they crystallize. If you see it carefully, what you would find that the same crystal is of two colors. One is slightly bluish and another is milky. There's
yes.
one milky over here, another milky over here, and another milky inside the cavity that looks like an ice cream. Look at that ice cream cone, which is white and hanging out there.
That is amazing. And
over
there, there is, what is that bone?
Okay.
That's the elephant bone.
Let's go there.
Yeah.
This is a thigh bone of an elephant, which was named as Planifron. So the name of this elephant is Planifron. This is the thigh bone of it, and this is the molar of this, the grinding tooth, right, of the same animal. And this was found.
This is one tooth.
No, there are several teeth over here.
Oh, so this entire. Okay.
This is part of the jaw.
Okay.
Part of the jaw preserved, right? You can imagine that when we found this, or my seniors, when they found it near Chandigarh from Shivalik Hills, it was not like this. It was in several pieces.
Oh.
So it has been carefully glued together to reconstruct the shape of the femur of the elephant. This elephant lived around 2 to 5 million years ago, and it is found in the mountains of Shivalik, all along the Himalaya. Nepal government issued a first day cover in the honor of this particular elephant, and
wow.
the original elephant looked like that.
So are they the ancestors of the Indian elephants, Asian elephants?
Kind of, yes, that's
okay.
right. That's right.
Amazing. Wow. That's a Nepal stamp?
That's Nepal stamp.
Yeah.
50 rupee Nepal stamp. That
oh,
the,
wow.
That the only image I could get
of
the original elephant.
Okay,
of
okay,
the original.
Okay.
Planifron was its name. Elephas planifron.
Planifrons. So I see a lot of other samples where every rock has been made in a different way, every crystal is made in a different way.
Right.
So take us through a few more
sure.
highlights
sure.
of your museum.
Sure. Well, right next to you is a crystal of calcite.
Okay.
This crystal is very special because this is transparent calcite.
Oh.
Right? We get calcite, but transparent calcite is not very common.
Okay.
The property of this transparent calcite is that if you see an object through this particular crystal, instead of one image, you will see two images.
Oh.
Because the calcite splits the light ray into two rays.
Huh.
It bifurcates
so
them.
This is what it's saying?
It is called as
refraction.
Double refraction. Right?
Okay.
So we can see the phenomena of double refraction right here.
Okay.
So how many circles you see here?
One.
Place this over this and see yourself how many images you see.
Oh, wow. Check it out.
There are two images, right?
Yeah, there are two circles.
Two images, right? You can sweep all these rectangles like this, and you will see that all of them are now showing two images.
Oh, wow. Double refraction, huh?
Yeah, that's double refraction. We used to use this kind of crystal for making the microscopes.
Oh.
Because sometimes in microscope we want double refraction, right?
Okay.
So in order to produce that double refraction phenomenon,
so calcite
this crystal was used. Right?
Okay.
Now we use some other alternatives, but long ago this was also used.
Okay. So what do we have here?
Okay. This is a big sandstone.
Okay.
This is a big natural sandstone. And you see little structures, those oblique lines
yeah.
on this, right?
So the lines that have gone.
They are the natural colors.
Mm.
They are the natural surfaces in the sandstone. If you have ever gone to a desert area, and if you see the section of the mountain in the desert area, you would see structures like that.
Yes.
Okay? So same structures you see preserved in this sandstone sample, which tells us that probably this sandstone formed in an environment which was desertic.
Okay.
So geologists use this kind of evidence,
yeah,
or a set of this kind of evidence in order to decipher in what kind of environment a particular rock was deposited. Because a rock can be deposited in what, in river water, in lake water, or in ocean water, or in desert. So by looking at this kind of structures or evidences, one evidence is not enough, but the whole set of evidence is collected, and geologists then infer that what was the original environment for deposition of a particular rock type.
Okay, right? Wow, that's fascinating. So what else samples do we have? Flexible sandstone.
Yeah.
So it's flexible?
It's flexible. Why it is flexible, you can see yourself. You can flex it.
Oh my God.
Right? This is because of the porosity. I wish one of you did it yourself.
Oh, I have to do this.
Experience.
Oh my God, it's like there is rubber inside.
Yeah. It's because of the porosity.
Okay.
So there's no rubber inside. It's because of the porosity. We found it near Haryana.
Yes.
But there are other places also where you get this kind of sandstone. If there was a lot of it, it will be very good, because then we could make all buildings by this particular sandstone.
They'll be shockproof, right?
And like they will be
protected from the earth.
Resistant.
Oh, that is amazing.
But good things always come in small quantities.
Yes. So it's a rare thing.
It's a rare thing.
Yeah.
That's the natural halite.
Yeah.
Two crystals that we got from Afghanistan. This is quartz crystal. Both are the quartz crystal.
Why are they different?
They are different in color.
Okay.
Right? Just as human beings come in different colors, minerals also come in different color. And color will depend upon the impurity in the mineral. Right? Suppose you have two buckets of water.
Yeah.
In one bucket of water, you drop a little bit of greening. In another one, you drop a little bit of redding. Mm. One water will be red, another water will be green. Similarly, little bit of impurity in a particular mineral changes the color of the mineral.
Yes.
Right? So the chemical composition is same.
Okay.
Its composition is same, its crystal system is same, but the color is different because of impurity.
Impurities in it. Okay.
This one is from Ladakh, and this is donated to us by wife of one of the professors here, Mrs. Rekha Singh.
Okay.
Right?
What is this?
This is again epiphyllite.
Oh, there are a few samples over there as well. Incredible.
Right. So these are epiphyllite, which is a cavity filling mineral.
Okay.
They come in various shapes and various crystals, and they look very beautiful. Most of these that we have got over here, epiphyllites, they are actually from Pune.
Okay. Okay. So is it similar to amethyst? That is also a cavity filling.
No. Epiphyllite and amethyst are two different minerals, but there is a whole family of epiphyllites, and different types of epiphyllites can also be seen.
Okay.
That's a realgar and orpiment in which we get sulfur and arsenic. So this is the mineral from which you can extract sulfur and arsenic if you want to.
So this is the raw form?
This is the raw form.
Yeah.
That's how you get it.
It's glittery.
Yeah. You can see another type of epiphyllite over there, right? That's also epiphyllite. This is Lonawala, is a place from Bombay to Pune highway.
Yeah.
It's from near Lonawala. Then we have a crystal of alum. Alum is actually pitkari. But you see the shape of the crystal.
That is the natural shape of the crystal.
Natural shape.
It's a pyramid structure.
That's also alum. This is also alum. I mean, as if somebody has drawn the line on a paper by using pencil and scale. So straight are the lines, right? Because there is a particular crystal system in which it grows. This blue color thing that we are seeing is cavansite. Is very rare. It is calcium vanadium silicate. That is why it is called
just the
cavansite.
Blue portion. Just the blue portion.
It is also occurring in a cavity.
Mm-hmm.
You can see this is surrounded by little white crystals which are radiating.
Yeah.
Right. So this is also a cavity mineral, but it's rare. Whereas epiphyllite is very common.
Yeah,
this one is rare. This one is rare.
Okay.
This one. These are some rocks from the Himalaya. The whole Himalayan mountain chain is cut by several faults, And this is one of the famous faults in Himalaya, which is Munsiyari thrust.
Okay.
So the white rock that you are seeing is different. Its age is very different. And the black rock that you are seeing, that age is very different.
Oh.
And in between, the contact between them is the plain along with the mountain has been cut.
So these are the two layers you're talking about, right? That blackish layer and then the top one.
The top one is grayish layer.
Yeah.
That is different age. And the whole white bunch. Is another layer.
Okay. So it shows two different times in the history.
Two very different times, and they are brought together because of this faulting or because of this cut in the Himalaya, right? This will go several kilometers deep.
Yeah.
Right. So the contact between these two is a cut or a main, or we call it as fault. This is actually called as Munsiyari thrust.
Okay.
So below Munsiyari thrust, you have Lesser Himalaya.
Oh, Lesser Himalaya.
And higher,
oh,
higher,
okay,
higher
okay,
Himalaya.
Okay, now
so
I
the contact is that one.
Okay.
Right? This we got near Munsiyari. So map of Munsiyari is there.
So talking about fault lines, I was reading in on your website that Professor H.B. Medlicott, he was the one who gave the term Gondwana land.
That's right.
So
that's right.
Tell us some more about that.
We'll
what happened?
Go to that corner of the museum where there is a map.
Oh.
So
let's.
So we can talk about that. But you can probably see this one also.
Yeah, let's check this one out first.
This is a mantle xenolith.
Okay.
So this has come from very deep in the earth, right? Below the crust, that green color mineral that you are seeing, that is a mantle xenolith of olivine, right? So this has come from very deep in the earth crust, earth mantle. Whole earth is divided into different layers.
Upper
one is crust, mantle, and core. So mantle
sample. So all the way from the mantle.
Mantle. So mantle sample are very rare.
Yes.
So this we imported from
and
Spain.
And this came from Spain.
Spain.
Yeah.
Spain,
wow.
Right?
So another sample
little,
of amethyst.
Little baby amethyst you can see. These are some of the complex structures that you get in Himalayan rocks.
Okay.
Right?
Okay. So now off to know more about Gondwana land.
Tell you that Professor Medlicott coined the name Gondwana land in 1876. 1854 he came here.
Okay.
1876 he coined the term Gondwana land, and 1877 he was honored by fellowship of Royal Society of London.
Whoa.
Right. So we all know that there was once upon a time a Gondwana land, India, South Africa, Madagascar, Antarctica, Australia.
Yeah.
They all were joined together in a big continent which was called as Gondwana land. This name Gondwana land was given by Professor H.B. Medlicott, and he named it while he was working in Madhya Pradesh, in MP, in the jungles of MP. There is a tribe which still lives. This tribe is called as Gondwana tribe, Gond tribe. So after the name of Gond tribe, he named this whole continent as Gondwana land.
So the Gondwa tribes, they are that old. They are older than the Santal tribes of.
It's not the age. It's not the age. But the name, why he named it Gondwana land? The name Gond came to his mind. Gondwana land came to his mind because he was working in Madhya Pradesh where Gond tribe used to live.
Okay.
We have. Some other highlights I can show you.
Yes.
See, rocks are deposited layer by layer by layer by layer like this, right? And because of the tectonic forces, sometimes they are rotated like this.
Okay.
Right? These structures we call as folds. So this is the axis about which this whole rock has been rotated. So here we have some samples of folds.
Oh yes,
we can
come this
we can see. You can see that the rock has been folded about this axis, right?
Whoa.
All of them are folds.
It looks like folded like paper.
Yeah, there, right there, another one.
Yeah, that one as well.
Another one, vertical, right here. The layer here is folded like this.
Yeah.
Just like this.
This one, no?
Just like this.
See? It's just folded like this, one.
Just like this. Just like this, this is the axis. Right? So all these are from very old rocks in Rajasthan. We call these rocks as banded gneiss.
I have never seen new samples of folded rocks. This is
like
so
this.
New.
Right?
Wow, that is crazy.
Right?
So let's move on.
we have two special sections.
Okay.
Here, Roorkee.
Yeah.
Right? So,
it's a local.
Local. Because okay. our students are commonly asked yes. in interviews, what are the rocks near Roorkee? What are the rocks in Rishikesh? What is the age of those rocks? So this section is about the rocks when you go from Rishikesh to Badrinath.
Ooh.
Right? So in that road section, you get different rocks. They are arranged in order of their ages.
Oh, wow.
So the oldest here will be this one.
Yeah, after the red sandstone and then
infra-crawl, then crawl A, then crawl B, then crawl C. So they are arranged in an order. Actually, okay. the oldest is this one, Blaney diamictite. Right? So they are arranged in an order. And these are the rocks that people will get or anybody would get when you travel from Rishikesh on Badrinath Road.
Okay.
Right? Another place people travel from Roorkee is Nainital.
Nainital.
Nainital. So we have rocks around Nainital, again arranged in a stratigraphic order or in order of the younging ages.
Wow.
Right?
So these are, so students who are who are studying in the earth science, they can actually study these rocks and
see these samples here, and then whenever they go to Nainital, they can identify these rocks. Okay, I have seen it in museum, the name of this rock is this, the
wow.
age of this rock is this. That's the objective of preparing shelves like this.
Yes.
Right?
Oh, that is amazing.
There are some more minerals here.
Ore minerals.
From which we get the metals.
Oh,
right?
That is so amazing.
So this blue and green is a copper ore. And this is donated to us by one of my friends, Professor Maincock, who came from Austria.
So the blue is copper.
Blue and green both are copper.
Okay,
one is
okay.
malachite, another is azurite. But both are copper.
So pretty.
And this cubical one is galena. This is sulfide of lead. So lead is extracted from rock like this.
And it crystallizes in that cube shape
In that cube shape, right?
Oh,
that's all natural.
Wow.
That's all natural. This one, where you have little, where you have this little circular things. This is bauxite. This is ore of aluminium.
Yeah, they're tiny gold. Circle.
Yeah, these are called piezolites,
okay.
and this is ore of aluminium. This is silomaline, which is ore of manganese.
This one. Wow. So that looks very attractive. Are those crystals? So we are checking out a few more crystals we find very attractive.
Those are again geodes in cavities. Right?
Yeah.
So different crystals, different minerals, mostly that one is epiphyllite.
Yeah.
Right? Epiphyllite is a kind of geolite mineral.
You were explaining. So
right?
This is another
form of epiphyllite. So geode means that they all have crystallized in the cavities.
Achcha.
We can see the original, this black thing, the black portion is the original rock in which the cavity has formed.
Oh,
so the white one is a part of the cavity.
So as you showed with that amethyst over there.
Same thing.
So it's like, so basically it's like a huge cavity, it's a cavity and
very big capsule in which the fluid is cooling, therefore it is precipitating or crystallizing the solid crystals. Because the rate of cooling is very, very slow,
okay.
and because there are some gases present in it along with the liquid, that's why the size of the crystal is very large.
Okay, and the entire thing is called a geode?
Entire thing is called a geode, cavity,
okay.
geode basically means cavity.
Okay, form. Okay.
Cavity form. You have seen those folded rocks, right?
Yeah, folded rocks we saw.
Sometimes rocks can get faulted.
Oh, so these are the faults.
These are, you see geological faults like this in class. You see one part has been displaced with respect to the other part.
Yeah.
There's a lateral motion over here.
See, check it out from the top. It's so clear. See? It looks like there were straight lines and somehow they got disturbed.
Yeah, yeah. They all were together.
Yeah.
They all were together in a straight band.
Yeah.
Then this band was cut by surfaces, which
yeah.
are called as fault. And along those cut, one part moved laterally with respect to the
yes.
other part. So these are faults. So those Himalayan faults are 2,500
yes.
kilometer long faults.
Ha, ha, ha.
This is few centimeter long faults.
Yes.
Right?
So it just
so at any scale, these things can happen.
So those are seashells kept over there?
Yes. We can have a look. this is from a lava or a volcano which was very, very old. This rock formed from that lava, and in the cavities of that lava, another mineral was precipitated.
So the dots that I'm seeing in that rock,
The light color ones.
Yeah.
The light color ones are actually amygdules.
Okay.
Or the cavities that were filled later on by other mineral.
Okay.
These cavities were initially circular.
Oh. Okay.
Right. But because of deformation, they have become elliptical.
Achha.
So geologists study these kind of structures and then try to find out that how much deformation this particular rock has suffered.
So by that they can understand the kind of
pressure,
the time and everything.
No, not time, but they can tell the
amount of deformation. Okay, okay.
Amount of deformation.
Wow.
Yeah,
this is interesting. These are not rocks.
No, these are done by paleontologists.
Okay.
They are different kinds of fossils which lived in different geological time.
Oh, wow.
So these are our shells of the fossil.
Yes.
The hard part of the fossil.
Yeah.
The soft part has gone away. It has been disintegrated or dissolved. So by looking at their ornamentation, by looking at their geometry and their shape, geologists identify what is the age of this fossil. And then same is the age of the rock in which these fossils are found.
Yes.
So we determine these are called index fossils. Huh. We determine the age of the rock by determining the age of
their age.
Because this is fixed.
Yes, yes.
The evolution of life is fixed, right?
And otherwise to date rocks, it's pretty difficult, right?
It's difficult
very
and
difficult.
Expensive. Not impossible, people do it routinely, but it's very expensive and very tedious.
What do you think are the problems with radiocarbon dating?
There is no problem with radiocarbon dating.
It's not 100% guaranteed, is
it? No. Carbon dating is also very good. Only problem is that equipments are expensive and we can't have one lab everywhere.
Yes.
Right?
Okay.
So these are some other shells. The fossils can also come in different sizes. You can see very small coiled shells there.
Yes.
Very, very small.
Oh, the right one.
Yeah. And this is very large.
Yes.
Right?
So
and
these are the nautical...
These are nautilus.
No, nautilus.
Nautilus.
Yes,
good.
Sorry.
Good. Nautilus kind of fossils. And you can see the coiling is also different. This is kind of helicoid. Very tight coiling. And it's lifting up also. This is different. This coiling is different. There's no ornamentation. This coiling is different. So, at different points of time, in geological time, the nature of the coiling change, the ornamentation change, and from there we identify what age of this mineral is.
Yes.
Right? This one is a very prized specimen. And
it's a whale skull.
This is the skull of the whale. And
but it seems so small.
No, this is just the skull. This is just the part of the skull of the whale, right? And this is very prized specimen, which this fossil was found by Professor Bajpayee from Gujarat.
Okay.
And this has very special importance because whale were initially land animal. They were not sea animal.
Yes.
Right?
Like millions of years ago
right.
It was.
Now they live in sea.
Yeah.
So there was a transitional stage around 42 million years, if I'm correct. Right. So this fossil or this animal lived in that transitional stage.
Oh my God. So basically this is a whale which was
going
from land to water.
Sea, land to water. And one can study one can actually do the DNA of this fossil. And
so
then
we can have DNA samples?
DNA of this fossil. And then they can find out that where it lived, what it ate. And all those different things with paleontological studies gave us that Professor Bajpayee has done work on this particular shell.
Around which time was this? Before the dinosaurs, right?
42 million
years.
But after dinosaur.
After dinosaur.
The dinosaur became extinct around 65 million years.
Yes, yes.
This is 42 million years.
Oh, okay. Got it.
So just as you have animal fossils, you also have plant fossils. So plants also evolved. You see from the top.
Is this a
leaf? That's a leaf.
Oh, that entire thing.
That entire big thing
See,
is leaf.
You have
and there are different kinds of leaf. So by studying different kinds of leaves, one can find out what is the
age. These impressions are so clear. The one on the left, extreme left.
The contrast is better.
That is so clear.
That
these look amazing. Just
amethyst.
Oh wow.
These are about the best that we
Wow!
These are beautiful.
These are huge.
If you heat epiphyllite, it will come out in flakes.
Seriously?
Yeah.
So if I heat these flakes,
will come out in flakes. That's why it is called epiphyllite.
Whoa. God, this is so colorful. Everything is so colorful.
We can see this two kinds of corals.
Okay, this is coral.
This is coral. And you see, this is natural glass which has come out of a volcano.
Oh my God.
Right?
So that glass came out of volcano.
I mean, lava came out of volcano.
Yeah.
The lava was solidified.
Yeah.
And it made this glass. That's also glass. But the color is different.
Whoa.
Right? This
so how does this happen? How does lava solidify to form glass?
Lava comes on the surface.
Yeah.
It's about 1200 degrees centigrade.
Yeah.
Atmospheric temperature is about 20 degrees centigrade.
Okay.
So much thermal jump.
Yeah.
Cooling, and it suddenly quenches. Because it quenches very fast, it has no chance to make any crystal. That's why you get glass.
Wow, that is so clear.
So we can
Now we are going to go to this incredible place.
UV room.
Yeah, UV. So that is the UV room. That is the only UV room in for a museum in India
and
in geology. And that is amazing. Just let's check that out. We'll see glow in the dark minerals, and they change color. If you see it in normal light, it is in one color, and if you change the light, if you see it in UV light, it's a completely different color.
This is the rock from the top of the Mount Everest.
Wow.
One of my friends is army captain. He climbed Mount Everest and he gifted me this particular specimen.
So this is right from the top?
Right from the top. This is limestone.
Oh my God.
This is limestone.
That is right? So amazing.
It was in my drawing room, but I decided that this was a better place for it. Right? So another thing we have. This is volcanic ash from Iceland. So Iceland is the only place where mid-oceanic ridge can be seen on the surface. Otherwise, mid-oceanic ridge is in the ocean, and you don't see the oceanic ridge. It's covered by the water.
Yes.
Iceland is the only place in the world where you can see the mid-oceanic ridge.
Okay.
Right? And this is the ash collected from that mid-oceanic ridge in Iceland.
Amazing.
Iceland. Now we can go to the UV room.
Yes. Let's do that. So it's going to be dark for a while.
Yes.
But just keep watching.
Okay. What we want to do, we want to see the color of these minerals in normal light.
Mm-hmm.
And then we will see the color of these minerals in UV light.
Yes.
Okay, so let's see the color of these minerals first in normal
light. Normal light.
And I want you to remember the color of these minerals. If you want, I can increase the light here for photography. Right?
Yeah.
The first one on your right, this one, can you point your finger?
Yeah.
You can
see?
Point finger from inside.
Oh.
Yeah. This reddish thing is actually ruby.
So these red dots are flecks of ruby.
Ruby in cordierite. Cordierite is another mineral.
Okay.
The next one, which is little dirty looking yellowish, that is fluorite.
So this is fluorite.
Right. The black in the dish, that paste,
this one,
that is tar or crude petroleum. Behind that is the refined petroleum, which is yellowish.
So this one.
Right? That lump, that unimpressive lump that you are seeing.
The huge one.
The huge one.
Yeah.
It has two minerals in it. It has ruby as well as it has zinc or willemite.
Okay.
So now we will see the color of
this. And this one, the tiny one?
The tiny one is scheelite or tungsten ore.
Okay, tungsten.
Right. This is very important.
The ore.
Ore,
okay.
Right?
Okay.
So now we will see the color of these minerals in UV light. Okay, so I'll turn off the normal light.
Yeah.
And turn on the UV light. Can I?
Yes.
Can I? Okay.
Whoa. Just look at the ruby.
So ruby
it's
is
glowing.
Glowing like fire.
Oh, wow.
Glowing like fire, right?
Wow.
that.
And the petroleum color completely changed. It was orange.
Now
no,
it was black. It was like the color of the Chavandar.
No, the refined
petroleum.
Yeah.
Right? So the next to ruby on your left is fluorite.
Yeah.
The fluorite was dark gray.
Yeah.
It is light blue now, right?
It was so dirty looking, and
dark
now
gray,
it's
dark blue.
Now it's a bright blue.
Right. Now the next to that in the dish was black paste, which was tar.
Tar.
Now tar
and now
light
it's gray
looks
tar.
White. It's white or grayish. Behind that, you rightly said there was orange color.
Yeah.
And that was refined petroleum.
Yes.
The refined petroleum is also white.
Whoa.
On the left of that, that little one, whatever is shining, is the ore of tungsten or scheelite.
So the shining bits are tungsten.
Tungsten.
Okay.
And in that lump, there are two colors that you see prominently, blue and red.
Yes.
The red one is ruby, as you have seen in the first mineral.
Yes.
The blue one, whatever blue you are seeing, that is willemite, which is an ore of zinc. Actually, geologists who explore for this kind of mineral, particularly for scheelite, they have a UV lamp on their hat.
Yes.
And this exploration is done in night.
Okay. So this particular, the big rock, it looked just like a normal everyday rock.
Very unimpressive.
Oh God,
very
this looks so pretty now.
Suddenly it becomes so attractive. This is also a unique facility here. I don't know of any other geology department, museum or ICER museum which has a UV room for seeing these fluorescent minerals.
Oh, this is seriously so beautiful. This is so beautiful. Okay, so let's go outside.
Should I turn it off?
Yes. Wow, sir, that was amazing. That is probably the most interesting thing I've seen here. Color-changing minerals. Who would have thought of that?
Please come again and you would find it better.
Yes,
I assure you.
Yes, so we were talking with Dr. D.C.
Srivastava.
And we had an amazing time checking out this amazing geological museum of H.B. Medlicott Museum, and he was the one who coined the term Gondwana land. I had no clue about this. This is so big, and he's the one who this museum is named after. So what are your future plans for this museum?
Improve this museum. Improve this. I'm going to put a microscope this week itself.
Okay.
And a slide on the microscope so that students can come and see that how a rock looks under the microscope. And improve few more things. Replace the samples, bring the better ones, replace older samples with the new ones.
Oh, wow.
Every year we go for field. I go to field very frequently.
Okay.
This museum has been built by donations also. Lot of my friends and colleagues and professors in other universities have donated the samples for our museum. Our own collection that our seniors did, and some of my own personal collection.
This is seriously beautiful, sir. You have done an
Thank
amazing
you.
Job. This
Thank
is
you.
A dream
Thank
come
you.
True. Seriously.
Thank you for encouraging.
Amazing.
And I again assure you, this time, next time, you will find it more attractive and more educative also.
Thank you, sir. So we were here at the H.B. Medlicott Museum of Geology at IIT Roorkee's Earth Science Department. I hope you enjoyed the small tour over here, and the fluorescent, the UV room was seriously mind-blowing. Keep watching for more live sessions and updates from IIT Roorkee. Thank you. With Divya, I am Roshni. There is Divya at the camera, and thank you for watching.